Good evening. Well, I'd like to welcome everyone to a joint meeting of Education Human Services as we kick off the FY22 budget. This is subcommittee and council meeting Tuesday, April 6th, and it's 6 p.m. A call to order. Pursuant to Governor Baker's March 12th, 2020 order suspending certain provisions of the open meeting law, GLC 30A, 18, and Governor's March 15th, 2020 order imposing strict limitations on the number of people that may gather in one place. This meeting of the town council is being conducted via hybrid, remote participation, and in-person here in chambers. No in-person attendance of members of the public will be permitted in council chambers, and every effort will be made to ensure that the public can adequately access proceedings as provided for in the order. A reminder that persons who would like to view this meeting while in progress may do so by watching Southbridge Cable Access, Channel 192, or by the remote information noted below. We will post a record of this meeting on the town's website. A roll call vote is required for all votes taken under this order. We do a roll call. Joe Catrona, myself, yes, I'm here. Councilor John Daniels?
Present.
Councilor Ryan?
Present.
Citizen member Holly Christo? I don't see Holly. Citizen member James Dyer?
Here.
Thank you. We have a quorum. Okay. We'll start first with a review of the fiscal year 2022 Bay Path Regional Vocational High School budget. And we're going to have a presentation from Dean Iacobucci and Kyle Brennan this evening. So I will let you guys start with the presentation and we'll go from there.
Through the chair, thank you. I'm Kyle Brenner, superintendent of Bay Path Regional Vocational and Technical High School, and I have our business manager, Dean Iacobucci, here with me this evening. And I'd like to recognize our school committee members, Ms. Helen Lenti and Mr. Rich Logan, who are the representatives for the town of Sutton as well. Southbridge, they were gonna join us this evening. I'll start with, the budget was developed based on the assumption that the school will resume 100% in-person learning, and that many of the health and safety protocols and practices we put in place to mitigate the viral transmission will remain in place next year. Additionally, the budget will maintain the core values of providing our students with high quality academic and technical education. The proposal continues our efforts to address not only our students' academic and technical needs, but also their social and emotional well-being. We are committed to our mission as well as maintaining our fiscal responsibilities to our member communities, especially during these difficult times. I'll turn it over to Mr. Iacobucci now.
Thank you. Can everybody hear me okay with the mask on, or do you want it off?
Whichever you prefer. If you can just speak into the mic, please.
Sure.
Thank you.
Is that better?
Yes.
Has everybody a copy of the presentation we're doing this evening? We emailed it over. I do have extra copies, that's why I'm asking. Beautiful. I'm going to try to be respectful of your time. I know you have a pretty busy agenda here this evening. So I'm going to try to move through this information quickly. If at any point in time you have any questions, please stop me. I'm not trying to skip over anything. I'm just going to move through it because it's pretty vanilla. So
okay.
Having said that, going to page two or slide two, it's important to note that our budget is developed based on the governor's numbers, just as your town budget is. So just like with your town's budget, if the budget changes through the state process of adopting a budget, that may impact our assessments and our budget as well. So our Chapter 70 funding has increased $327,020. Our Chapter 71 funding, which is regional school transportation, is a decrease of $309,051. And again, these are preliminary numbers. So how does that shake out for Bay Path? Our required net school spending increased by $1,215,935. making our required net school spending for next year $21,398,161. How is that funded? It's funded by our Chapter 70 funding of the $11,570,228, and then the minimum contributions that are required by our 10 towns collectively, which total $9,827,933. Page 4, slide 4, our total budget for assessment purposes is $24,561,858, and we want to stress that our assessments to all our 10 towns are at minimum. It doesn't go any lower than what we have before you this evening. The budget includes debt service of $1,564,103, and as I said earlier, our member assessments total $11,745,288. It's very important to stress that although our assessments are at minimum, it's important to note that the minimum contribution levels that each town must contribute have increased collectively by $888,915. And we stress that because sometimes we hear criticism that we are only requesting minimum from our towns. But it's important to note all of our towns collectively are giving us almost $900,000 more. And that in and of itself is quite a large increase. Members' towns' transportation assessments have been reduced by $300,000, reflecting the use of our newly created Regional Transportation Reimbursement Fund. And as some of you may recall, last year in June, the school committee voted to adopt this provision of the law, which sets up a special reserve account. And we did this because, as you know, in March, school came to an abrupt halt. We had money in our budget for transportation expenses that never materialized as a result of not transporting students to school. The district could have kept those revenues that we received from the towns and the state and closed them out to our free cash, but instead of doing that, the school committee created this fund. We transferred the surplus appropriations into this fund, and we're using those funds totaling $425,000 to offset this year's assessments for transportation. We believe, again, that at the end of this year, we'll have approximately $300,000 in surplus revenues for transportation, and we will again be voting, or the school committee will be voting, to move those funds into the Transportation Reimbursement Fund, and that will offset next year's transportation assessment for the towns, and you'll see how that shakes out in a minute. We do receive a school choice assessment of $197,697, and that comes right off of our Chapter 70 funding. Our Chapter 71 busing aids, $899,039. We continue to pay a sewer betterment fee to the town of Charlton of $30,750. We are continuing to appropriate from our excess and deficiency, which is the same as the town's free cash account, of $50,000 to continue funding our OPEB liability. And we've also reserved $150,000 in excess and deficiency for any unknown COVID-related expenses. This, again, is held as a reserve. As you know, your ability to use your free cash ends on June 30th, and you don't get the opportunity to appropriate from it until it's recertified. For our district, our free cash, or our E&D, won't be certified until next January or February, probably at the soonest. So by doing this and incorporating it into the budget and into the budget vote, it makes $150,000 of free cash available to us in the event we have some large unrelated expenses that we need to deal with at the start of the school year. So this is really just being done as a safeguard and has no impact whatsoever on the assessments to the towns. So on slide number 7, you can see how our budget shakes out. Our total operational budget is $21,400,464, and that's funded by our Chapter 70 funding, You see the reduction for school choice. You see the assessments at the minimum level for the towns, the E&D transfer for the OPEB liability, and the $150,000 for any unbudgeted COVID-related expenses, and that totals our $21.4 million operational budget. Below that, you see the transportation budget. Our estimated costs next year are $1,521,541. That amount is offset by the Chapter 71 revenue of $899,039. You see the Transportation Reimbursement Fund allocation of $300,000, leaving only $322,502 to be assessed. And I say only because not that's a small number, but because without having adopted that reimbursement transportation fund, the assessments to the 10 towns collectively would have been $622,000. Below that, you see the debt service, and that's for the borrowing that we did for the $73 million renovation. And below that, you see the capital sewer assessment tie-in of $30,750, making our total budget for assessments $24,516,858. And then when you add the school choice assessment back in, it makes our total operating budget with school choice of $24,714,555. Moving to slide 8, so what's in our budget? We've included funds to supply all of our academic classes as well as our vocational programs. We've included funds for new textbooks for social studies and the veterinary science program, which will be starting in the fall, and we have a small reserve for any necessary replacements of existing textbooks. We've also included funds to make some equipment purchases for our advanced manufacturing program and for the vet tech program. On page 9, we've included funds to add one full-time equivalency of the vet science teacher. We've included funds to add one history teacher to address class sizes. We've included funds to restore a part-time vocational job site coordinator. And that's a little misleading. This is a position we always had in our budget. At the end of last fiscal year, the gentleman who occupied that position resigned to take another position. We chose this year not to fill that position because we have fewer students out on co-op, and being in a hybrid model, have fewer students in the school at any point in time and going out on job co-op. So we reallocated those funds this year, but we're bringing that position back for next year. At any point in time, we have approximately 150 students out at the same time at job sites, and someone needs to go out there, check the job site, check on the students, make sure the work is in alignment with the student's vocation. It's a big job. And it's filled rather nicely with a part-time position that solely has that as a responsibility. And we've included wages for all of our union and non-union employees for increases. We've included funds in the line item budget to continue with online learning if necessary. We are hoping that those funds or that appropriation will decrease significantly with the in-person starting with any luck at the end of this month. And if so, we'll reallocate those funds to other expenses. We've also included funds for the Student Opportunity Act, which was some new legislation that was supposed to go into effect this year that caused an increase in Chapter 70 funding. But because of the pandemic, the state postponed the implementation of that until next year. So because we get an increase in Chapter 70 funding, that increase needs to be spent on services related to the Student Opportunity Act. And then finally, I just threw this in because it's a bit of very good news. You may recall several years ago, we sat before you and we had told you that we had switched our insurance provider, going from a small self-funded group to a large consortium of about 70 other school districts and towns. That instantaneously stabilized our rates just because of the size of the buying power. We then met with all of our employment groups, and it's going to keep ringing. We then met with all of our employment groups and renegotiated our plan design with them. We increased co-pays and we introduced a deductible. And all of our unions and our employment groups agreed with that, because the promise at that point was it will continue to stabilize rates. And this was 2 years ago. For the past 2 years, our rates have been the same. We've seen no increase. And next year, we're going to actually see a 2% decrease. And if you're following any municipal budgets, it's not uncommon to see increases in health insurance anywhere from 2%, you know, to double digits. And the fact that our rates are going down 2% is just great news. In fact, our rates next year will be only slightly higher than what our rates were 7 years ago when we were our own self-funded group. So it has really stabilized our health insurance. And we need to thank our employment groups for that, because they didn't need to come along for the ride, and they did. On slide number 11, you see how our freshman seat allocations for next year are broken out by town. We are anticipating bringing in 315 freshmen. Southbridge owns 43 of those seats. On page 12, you see a breakdown of our foundation enrollment.
Dean, do you have copies of that?
Of this, yes, I do.
Because we're looking at a budget book, and we don't have copies of what you're seeing, but we can vaguely see it on the screen.
Yeah, no, I do have copies of this. And I also have copies of the line item budget that we submitted to you back in January. If you need that, I've got extra copies of that as well.
Thank you again.
So right now we're on page 12, or slide number 12.
Thank you.
And you can see how all of the foundation enrollment, thank you, Mike, how the foundation enrollment at BayPath shakes out by town. We are, and our Chapter 70 funding is based on 1,200 students. You can see that 207 of those students are from Southbridge, which is a decrease of 4 students over the current year. How does that affect Southbridge and your financing? We'll get into it in a minute. But here's the town of Southbridge's foundation enrollment. Your foundation enrollment for your public schools has decreased by 21 students, and then for our school has decreased by 4. So you're seeing 25 fewer students, which is certainly impacting the Chapter 70 funding that the town receives. And in a minute, we're going to see some trends of your total student population and what's happened with that. So why do we talk about those numbers? And I'm on page 14. The first thing is the state calculates your required local contribution. And that's probably the easiest part of the Chapter 70 formula that you're going to find. They basically start with this year's required contribution, and they take the town's minimum revenue growth factor, and they increase this year's contribution by that. I know you may often hear about the municipal revenue growth factor. This is one of the areas on how it impacts your town. So your local contribution gets increased by your municipal revenue growth factor. For Southbridge, that increases $8,983,523 to $9,249,435. Now, the state also creates each year what is referred to as a target share of the contribution. And that's the state saying, all right, here's what your required local contribution is, but here's where it should be. In Southbridge's case, your required local contribution by this calculation is slightly larger than what the state calculates the town's local contribution should be. So as a result of that, you see a reduction due, or termed excess local effort. So your required contribution calculated by your municipal revenue growth factor is decreased by $54,722, making your required local contribution next year $9,194,713. And what the state is saying is that at a bare minimum, that's the amount the town needs to fund education going to the Southbridge Public Schools, a portion coming to Bay Path, and if you had any students going out to agricultural schools or any tuitioned out students, that would be included in that as well. The next number that the state calculates is your foundation budget. And again, that is a budget that the state determines that the town should have as a minimum for your community, for your educational entities that you're funding. The foundation for the town of Southbridge or your public schools, the foundation budget is $31,747,453, which represents 89.58% of the total foundation budget. And we're going to focus on those percentages in a minute. Bay Path's share of that foundation budget is $3,691,183, or 10.42%. And why are we focusing in on those percentages? We'll see on slide 15. Those percentages are then applied to your local required contribution, and that determines your minimum local contribution. So you can see how your share of the required contributions, I'm in about the middle of the page at the top chart, you can see the 89.58% for the town of Southbridge and the 10.42% for Bay Path applied to your required local contribution. Your minimum required contribution to the Southbridge Public Schools is $8,237,019, and to Bay Path is $957,694. So that's where some of the numbers that you see and that you hear come from. So we hope that that's helpful for you. On page 16, this is probably one of the most important things I'm going to show to you this evening. This is information that's derived at from a report that is filed annually with the Department of Education called the School Attending Children Report. This is also what we use to calculate your debt service assessment and your capital assessment. That's why we track it and why it's important to us. But this is also provides some very telling, and I'm going to say startling, information. I'm going to start by going all the way to the right-hand side of this form. And we're looking at the third column in from the right. These are the school-aged students residing in each of our towns, but we'll focus on Southbridge in a minute. That reside in your town, regardless of where they go for education. This includes homeschooled students, school choice students, students going to private school, students going to public school, students being tuitioned out. This is all of them. And if you look at the town of Southbridge, for the information that we have for the most current year, which is based on counts from January 1st, 2020, you have 2,511 school-age students residing in the town. That is a decrease of 88 students over the students that are from January 1st, 2019. And if you look back to January 1st, 2013, you have lost a total of 210 school-age students. That has nothing to do with how your school system is, how our school system is. That's just indicating there are 210 fewer school-age students living in the town of Southbridge. Now, when you think about how that translates to dollars, not only for you, but for us, those are 210 fewer students, K through 12, that we would normally be receiving Chapter 70 funding for. And then if you look down on the bottom line, and this is the startling part, look at us as a district. Since 2013, we have 1,221 fewer school-age students. Think of the millions and millions of dollars that are not flowing into our district as a result of there being that many fewer school-age students. It's a trend that's happening statewide. There are very few towns that are seeing increases. There are some out there. In fact, there are some within our district. But largely, overall, statewide, you're seeing a decrease of school-age students, and that has a direct impact on the funding coming into the town of Southbridge and into Bay Path. On page 17, you see our assessments that we have for each of our towns, but we'll look at Southbridge's. It starts in the second column in from the left, your minimum contribution, and we saw earlier how that was calculated. For Southbridge, it's $957,694. Moving across to the middle, you may recall that I had said the total amount that we're assessing for transportation is $322,502. Southbridge's share of that is $55,632. And again, if we didn't have that regional school transportation fund, your assessment for transportation would be almost doubled. So you can see how that's a direct return to the towns. Again, moving across, you'll see actually the next column where you see capital population. That's the information that we just went on over on that school sending children report. We use those numbers to calculate the ratio that your debt service and capital assessments are allocated. So you can see your share of the debt service is $215,533, and your share of the capital improvement, that $30,750, is $4,237, making your total assessment $1,233,096. So how does that compare to this year? You'll see a 1.62% decrease in your overall assessment, a total decrease of $20,297. And why is there such a decrease? Again, you have fewer students at Bay Path, and you have fewer students overall in that school attending report, which is reducing your share of the debt assessment because of the loss of students in K through 12. The next information that we put on this doesn't impact Southbridge, and I actually debated whether or not to include it or not. You're one of two towns that this section of the governor's budget doesn't impact, but you may have heard about it, so I thought I'd give you the quick 10-cent tour of it. In the governor's budget, he provided language that allows towns access to some of the ESSER II funds that the district is going to get to fund increases in minimum local contribution levels. You're not seeing an increase in the minimum local contribution level, so you don't have access to these funds. But I wanted to explain it to you just in case you've heard about it. It's been a buzz in the education world, and there's heavy lobbying going on right now to get this language out of the state budget so that the school districts aren't required to, if you will, share their ESSER II funds with the communities. But if you look on slide number 20, you'll see how that pans out for our 10 towns. And again, I won't focus too much on this, but you can see based on the allocation and what the legislation provides is that 75% of our ESSER II funds from the state can be used to lower allocations, increases in minimum local contributions. Our ESSER II allocation is $447,033. 75% of that is $335,275. That's the very most that could be applied to lower towns' local contributions. Because we have two towns that are seeing a decrease in local contribution, and then some of our towns having local contribution increases lower than what their share of this 75% would be, our district would see a decrease in the ESSER II funds of $251,165. Again, because Southbridge's local contribution decreased to begin with, there's no ability to use an allocation of our ESSA funds to lower your local contribution. So I wanted to include that just in case you've heard talk about how some of our grant funds can lower towns' contributions. There's no impact on the town of Southbridge, again, because your local contribution decreased and didn't increase. And again, I'm not going to spend any time on these next charts because it just showed how our town's minimum contributions changed and how their total assessments changed. And again, what we've done at our level at Bay Path is we have recommended to the school committee not to include any of these calculations in the assessments that we're providing to our towns, because if they did vote to lower those assessments and then this legislation was cut out of the state budget, 9 of our 10 towns would have to hold special town meetings to get that funding back in. It didn't make any sense. The school committee has already committed to returning those funds, and in fact, the legislation puts the sole discretion at the hands of the municipalities. All a municipality's Board of Selectmen needs to do is vote to apply their grant share to their minimum local contributions, and the school department has to lower it. But again, unfortunately, it doesn't have an impact on Southbridge. So I've thrown a lot of information at you in a short amount of time. We'd certainly be happy to answer any questions you have.
Thank you. Councilor Ryan?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, through you to Superintendent Brenner and Mr. Iacobucci. I just thank you for the wonderful presentation. As always, you guys give us a lot of information, and it's always, you're always transparent about everything going on, and I deeply appreciate that. I do have a couple of questions going through your line item budget, some things that kind of stuck out to me. One was you talked about how you're going to be going, anticipating going back full-time in person with the next year, but then you increased the online teaching by 125%.
Right. So. It's a little misleading because the amount we're spending this year does not reflect accurately in that that chart.
Is it because of federal funds coming in?
Yes. And our local funds this year, or our local expenses, are being offset significantly by those federal funds coming in.
Perfect, thank you. That answers that question. Again, I'm very happy about the veterinary program getting off. I was really supportive on the school committee when I was there of this program. I'm happy to see it because it's not one we don't see in the region. So it'll give kids a nice opportunity and outlet and something different. I also saw that under the instructional equipment section, there was an 85% reduction in special education classroom supplies, and I wanted to know what that was about.
This year was the first year that we included that in our line item budget. So we loaded it up because we knew we would have one-time expenses in allocating and setting up the sped classrooms. It really was a new account number this year.
Okay.
We put a lot of money in it. And next year, it's really more just for maintaining the supply levels. There's no reduction of services whatsoever in there.
Perfect. Thank you for that. That's wonderful. You said that overall in the you're seeing a reduction in transportation costs because of the money we've saved. Under the medical and health services section, transportation after school, there's a 100% increase in that.
I'm sorry, what
under section? The medical / health services section, line 441, transportation after school, there was a 100% increase in that. Just I was just curious if that was an expansion of like an after school program or on the job training opportunities.
I just want to see the line that you're looking at so I don't misinform you, Councilor. What page of the line?
Page 17.
Book? Thank you.
Third section down, medical and health services, line 441. Account number 441, excuse me.
And which line item are you looking at?
Line, account number 441, transportation after school.
I'm on a different page than you. Okay, I'm getting there.
Oh, that's why. It's the budget actually starts on page 10 on ours. That's why.
Transportation after school, what are you seeing as?
100% increase in that.
I don't know what you're looking at because I have a 1.63% increase on my budget.
I have it circled online. Look at that instead, if that would make it easier. Sorry about the confusion.
Yeah, no, I think. Right.
Okay.
The updated budget.
Oh, did it get updated?
It got updated. We transferred funds into that account this year, which aren't reflected on your budget.
Okay.
On the updated proposed budget, which I have plenty of copies to give you, you'll see that the transportation after school budget this year is $27,253 and not the zero that you see in your budget.
Okay, so it was just a mistype in the thing, or?
No, it was the transfer occurred after this budget was created.
Gotcha, okay.
Yeah, the expenses haven't changed, but any transfers that occurred this year, we didn't increase the budget, but shifted money around, so. There's a bunch of extras.
And then I just have one more question. Under the maintenance of buildings, building security systems, line item 1606, there was a 98.4% reduction in the security system, and I was just wondering what that
Thank
was
you.
About.
This year, and actually last year, we went on a pretty aggressive campaign to update all of our security cameras in that system. And again, that reflects the fact that that's program's now done.
Okay.
We've updated all of our security cameras as well as the software that's used to read them.
Perfect. Thank you. That's all the questions. As always, you guys have answers to every question I have. So
thank you, Councilor Ryan.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Daniel?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, through you. I've got a couple of different kinds of questions, I guess. Can you hypothesize why we're getting such a drop of students from Southbridge?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you, John.
Can you hypothesize about why we've got such a drop of students coming from Southbridge?
Are you talking the overall school attending child report or at Bay Path?
At Bay Path.
Large, you know, senior class going out and, you know, a smaller freshman class coming in.
Mm-hmm.
Typically what happens is we allocate seats at Bay Path. In the past, sometimes three or four of our towns didn't use all of their seats, mm-hmm. and we reallocate them to other towns. We have been finding that, though the four towns soon became three towns, soon became two towns, and most of our towns, I think with the exception of one, now uses all of their allocated seats. Mm-hmm. So there's less seats for us to reallocate to other towns to address waiting lists that are in there.
Okay. That sewer tie-in fee, is that an ongoing fee or is that a betterment fee?
That's a 20-year betterment fee.
20 years.
And I believe next year is the last year.
All right. Are you getting a water betterment fee as well coming up? Or?
We just hooked up to the town water.
Okay.
Friday. So we are now customers of the Southbridge Water Supply Company.
Best water in the state.
Best water in the state. And right. What's really good about it is we're no longer Massachusetts water operators. That gets shifted on to you folks now.
correct me if I'm wrong, but you only have $35,000 or $30,000 in capital expenses coming up this year? Did I misread the budget?
We don't have any.
You don't have any
The
at
only
all?
Capital expense we have is that sewer tie-in.
And that's it?
That's it.
Okay. And referees and umpires are raising their fees this year?
We're hoping.
Yeah. Okay, I'm all set. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Do you have any other questions? Anyone online?
I just have one quick question.
Councilor Marchetti?
On your presentation here, your ESSER 2 recommendations, when do you think you will know if we're going to get ESSER 2 funding?
We won't know until the state adopts a budget. Now, we're hopeful that the state will adopt a budget by June. But as we saw this year, the state didn't adopt the budget until December. Now, granted, this was a very unusual year, but, you know, personally, and I tend to be a bit of a skeptic, you know, a pessimistic type of person, but I'd be very surprised if we see a budget before June.
And if you do get it, it says here that in the event the provision is included, then it will be voted by our school committee. We're under receivership, so it would be up to our receiver to decide that?
I didn't hear the question.
So if we do get it, it's up to the receivership to vote it. But I think that's a moot point.
Right, yeah. For Southbridge, that section of the law doesn't apply. It typically would be up to the town council to vote that. However, you have no money coming back to you because your local contribution has decreased anyway. It only can be used to fund increases or to reduce increases.
Okay. I thought you said that there is a effort to change that.
No, there's an effort to eliminate it so that the 8 towns that would have the ability to lower their local contributions, they're trying to remove that ability. So that, for instance, in our ESSER grant, that amount that the 8 towns could vote to lower their local contributions is $251,000 of federal grant funds coming to our district. So you can see why the educational side is lobbying hard to get rid of that, because if it isn't included in the final budget, quite frankly, we have $251,000 more to apply to our budget, our expenses.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Citizen Member Dyer? Do you have any questions this evening?
No questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Ryan?
Mr. Chair, I make the motion that we recommend the council the acceptance of the fiscal year 2022 Bay Path Regional Vocational Technical High School budget in the grand total amount of $24,516,858.
I'll second that.
Motion seconded by Councilor Daniels. Let me take a roll call.
Mr. Chair, before you make the roll call, I'd like to make a note that Holly Christo is now at the meeting.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Chair.
Is that Karen?
Karen and Gus.
Karen?
Yeah. Chairman Catrona, if I could, what the motion needs to be is to approve the Bay Path budget in the amount of $1,233,096, which is the town of Southbridge's share.
I'll accept that as a friendly amendment.
Thank you.
I'll accept that.
Okay, thank you. We have a first and a second. Thank you, Karen. Okay, with that being said, we'll take a roll call. Councilor Daniel?
Yes.
Mr. Chair, I'm sorry, Gus Steves did have his hand up.
Okay, I didn't see you, Gus.
That's okay, Karen. Karen said what I was going to say.
Oh, perfect. Okay. I just wanted to make sure.
Mr. Town Manager, Michael, do you have any questions this evening?
No.
Thank you.
This time. Thank you, gentlemen.
Okay. Roll call. Councilor Daniel.
Yes.
Councilor Ryan.
Yes.
Citizen Member Dyer.
Yes.
Citizen Member Christo.
Yes.
And myself, Joe Catrona, I'm a yes as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Pleasure
Thank
seeing you
guys.
Again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Nice to see you again. Thank you. Okay. Next on our agenda, agenda item number 2 is review the fiscal year 2022 library budget.
And we will entertain a motion to vote to submit to council as presented.
So moved.
Thank you. Second?
Second.
Thank you. Do we have a presentation from Margaret?
I think the manager wants to speak first.
Or the town manager?
Well, I will defer to Ms. Morrissey in a moment. I just wanted to preface this being the first evening that we're talking about the budgets. Just mention again that when we Ms. Harnois and I met with all the various departments, we had sent out the memo early on talking about level service budgets and asking everybody to make do with the line items they had last year, except for the salaries, similar to Bay Path, for the union and non-union salary increases. As we start with the library, I just want to say that we took a position during COVID, and when I came here, that if positions became available due to people leaving, or if we had to have reductions in staff, that we would keep those positions open. And then I made a pledge to Ms. Morrissey that when we came back, I asked her to put those positions back so that she could function as she normally would in a normal non-COVID year. I was fortunate enough to get my tour of the library this spring, and the library here is a great community asset. And one of the things before we get into their budget, I just want to put in a plug for the library, because I think the library in every community is a huge resource. It's a great equalizer. It doesn't matter what your socioeconomic status is. Everybody can walk into that library. Everybody can take out a book. Everybody can get an assistance. It's one of the things that truly serves the community. So that being said, I want to hand it over to Ms. Morrissey. But again, the positions that are there, many of them were left open during COVID, and she worked with a shorthanded staff, and they actually dealt with COVID at the library. So she's managed quite well for the last almost year now, and I applaud her efforts during that time period.
Thank you. Welcome, Ms. Morrissey. Good evening.
Good evening, Town Council members, and good evening, Town Manager. Thank you for the opportunity to present the budget for the Jacob Edwards Library and our request. I would just
Excuse me. You might want to move your microphone closer. Oh,
thank you.
Just to give you the highlights first, the library request is an increase of 1.7% on previous year, which is reflective of a 2% increase in wages, plus the minimum wage for the minimum wage groups that we have at the library. So I think we did pretty well overall in trying to keep within the outline that we were given by the town manager. And as the manager pointed out, it was a negotiated budget. This wasn't what I came to the table with first. And I'm very pleased to think that we can work with this budget during the year. And at this point, I would just like to express my gratitude to the staff at the library. The staff has been tremendous throughout a very difficult time. And I think we've managed pretty well and been flexible. And it's thanks to the supportive groups around us, such as the Board of Trustees, the Friends of the Library, and of course our colleagues at Town Hall, who give us a lot of backup. And I just think it's a wonderful thing to have such a cooperative group to rely on. So in your packet, we start off with salaries and wages. So there's two different groups here. One is full-time, that's more than 30 hours a week, and that's the figure of 290,294. And that is comprised of some of the vacant positions that the manager has referred to. At the moment, the adult services librarian position is vacant and has been actually advertised. So we're hoping to have an incumbent pretty soon to fill that position. There is a request here, and I'll just point out where it says S8 max. It's one, two, three. It's the fifth paragraph in page two of your budget. And just, I want to mention that I am hoping that we can have an increase for a staff member who has taken on a lion's share of duty, and I feel the position is undergraded, or you know, it needs to be graded at a higher level because of the level of responsibility that has been incurred. And the change, though, effectively, if you're familiar with the staff scale, each scale has 5 points. And so if we start with scale one has 5 points, and scale two has the second point of scale one as the starting point of scales two, and so on. And each has 5 points and progresses up with a 5% increase. So what I'm asking for here, the person is already at the top of the S7 scale, and the next scale up is S8. And I'm hoping that we can discuss this proposed increase as part of later conversations. But I've put it in here in the budget so that we'd have a place marker. If you'd like me to continue with discussing it, I can, but I just wanted to give you an outline about it first.
Please. You can continue.
Continue with this position? Talking
yes.
About this, yeah. So this person would not be entitled to longevity. The effective increase is $1.31 per hour, which works out at $2,565 a year. But as I say, there would be no future steps and no longevity. And I think it would make for a more secure staff arrangement, and we've already seen the benefits of this already and the flexibility that comes with a staff member working out of grade already.
Thank you.
So the next, so there are two vacant positions. One vacant position, but you can see two different pay rates because there's a step involved. So we're looking at admin assistant 3. We have used the date of 5-1. This is in consultation with the CFO and the HR specialist to try and figure out where we would be rehiring staff. So we'd need a date for the step. So we just picked 5-1. And I'm hoping that we can start hiring positions and start opening up really soon. So that's what we're reflective here. Then we move to the next grade, which is the part-time people. And we have two S5s. So you see the 35,737 and the 24,426, but it has a step. So that's, so there's two positions, but there's three, you can see there's three totals there because it's a step. Sorry. So the 24,426 plus 5,191 is that person's salary. It includes a step, anticipating that they'll go up one from the minimum to step one. And then we have two other categories, library aides and library pages. We are scheduled to be staffed with three library aides. We only have one in place at the moment. And then we have two page staff and the same. We only have one in place at the moment. And each of those grades are part of the minimum wage increase. So they are all showing an increase, which starts of January 1st of 2022. So that gives you the total there of 103,359 added to 290,294 for salaries. So there's a 1.3 increase and a 2.8 increase as shown. Then four people are entitled to longevity as per the rules and regulations. And that has actually been decreased by one person. So there's zero increase in that this year. So that's 3,934. And then we move to the utilities. So electricity, we have estimated at $15,000 based on a three-year average. But because this year wasn't really an average year, we've had to fudge factor that. And you'll see the calculations in under the electricity, the 5210 account. Because we're not open on Saturdays at the moment, we have made some small savings in electricity. So the request is for $15,000, which is an increase of 2.74%. Natural gas, which is the 5211 account, we are requesting $18,900, which is based on the average that we've used and some anticipated increases in natural gas. We were given the direction to increase water and sewer with a 4% increase, so the calculation for that is $3,536, which is a 4% increase. One of our largest line items is repair and maintenance of buildings, 5243. That is staying the same, no increase, $20,500. And the library has always tried to be a good steward of the building. It's over 100 years old. We have been rated as having a good maintenance program with the facilities management assessment that was done there about 4 years ago. We were actually the highest rated building in town. And we do try to do the maintenance that's pointed out to us as it occurs. So the stewardship there, we try to take care of, and we do it with the $20,500. So hopefully this year that will be good as well. We have a photocopier office equipment lease of $1,100 from RICO. Then the account 5300 is for program services, which covers our movie license. So when the library is in full operation, we have a movie screening, we have surround sound and comfy seats in our Pioppi room, and we show a movie once a month, and it's the friends of the library that help to put this program together. So that license to do that legally is $460. Data processing, which is the 5302 account, is our request is $36,250, which again is not reflecting an increase, although we will be absorbing a small increase from our network, but I think we can do it within the parameters that we have. Print forms, which is 5342, is staying the same at 300. Office supplies, which is 5420, we have increased that by 20%, but it comes from two other line items. From $100 each, we have reduced 5710, which is mileage on in-state travel, we've reduced that by 28%. And 5711, conference and meetings, that has also been reduced by $100. So that's where we've made that $1,200, which is $200 of an increase on office supplies on FY 21. Copy machines supplies stays constant at $2,000. Janitorial and house supplies at $2,200. Buildings and grounds, $1,000. Miscellaneous materials, $500. Recreational materials, $850. All these have stayed at zero, and including our book request. And I'd just like to focus on the book request at the moment, books and materials. Under the state aid program that we're part of, and we're delighted to be part of, the library has to spend a certain amount of its budget depending on the demographic of the community. So Southbridge, we're in a category that we have to spend 15% of our our total TAMI, or the total municipal appropriation, has to be 15% of that has to be spent on books and materials. And we do it in two ways, which is allowed by the state aid program. Just slightly over half is paid by the town in the operating budget, which is 42,000, I'm sorry. And the trustees of the library always have been contributing $40,000 towards this fund. And there will be a slight increase in the request this year to meet the overall state requirement, which is 15% of the TAMI, which the TAMI this year is $549,733. So it's 15% of that. As I mentioned earlier, we have decreased the following two line items, 5710, mileage in-state travel. We've decreased that by $100, and 5711, conference and meetings, by the same $100, because we feel that we're not driving to meetings and attending meetings in person. There's a lot more doing, you know, even more so now during COVID, that, you know, everything is digitized. So, you know, we're using that method to communicate with our different associations and other library directors and whomever. Dues, subscription and periodicals request, which is 5730, is 950, which stays the same. And I have put in this year for a small capital budget of $2,000. We have a capital budget at the moment for the installation of copper gutters on the west side of the building, which would be on Foster Street. And when we had some contractors come and look at the building, it was found that there's a lot of pointing needed on the brickwork and the brick facade. And it would make more sense to do the project altogether, especially if there's scaffolding involved. So we're proposing that we would do the project together, but we will need some more money. And I think we will be putting some money from state aid towards this as well, from the library state aid money that we receive. So $2,000 is what we're asking for as part of a small capital budget to increase the budget that we have already, but to cover for the pointing, which wasn't anticipated when we started to talk about the copper gutters. And it's actually from the wear and tear for not having the gutters that we now have the problem with the facade. So it's a, you know, it's just the next step that we need to take in order to be mindful of our duty to be a steward of the building. And we have a $400 office equipment request in account 5855 at the end as well for some small equipment that we would need to cover.
Thank you, Ms. Morris.
Sorry.
Much appreciated. Questions? Councilor Ryan?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Through you to Ms. Morrissey. I know we've talked about this in years past. You have to have a 2% increase over an average over, is it 5 years, I believe?
Three years.
I knew it was three or five. I knew it was an odd number.
Thank you.
So with only the 1.66% increase this year, are we looking at next year having to have a possible higher percentage increase in order to keep that state accreditation?
Possibly. This year, the MAR works out at $549,105. So we're just under, the MAR is just under what the operating budget request is. But next year, as it's a three-year average, that will, so, sorry. Just. Okay, so FY19 was 526,548 for the TAMI. FY20 was 539,817. FY20 was 540,772. So you can see the 3-year average then worked out at 535,712 and 2.5% of that gave us the 549,105. So we will meet the requirements for state aid this year. Next year, maybe we might have a push and need more funding. But in keeping with the manager's request to try and have a level funded budget and to get through what we expected was going to be a difficult fiscal year and not making onerous requests, I thought it prudent to come up with, as I said, I did have a higher figure first, but we negotiated down to this, and I think this is something both the CFO and the town manager and the library can live with.
Okay.
So I think it's reasonable. But thank you for the question, because I should have mentioned that.
No, and thank you. I always appreciate the information you give us. This is one, our library is one of the best in the region by far. We get recognized for our great library, and it's because of your great leadership and your staff there. And it's really important to me that we continue to keep that accreditation because it is such a good library, and I don't want to risk losing that. So that's why I'm always very cognizant and very wary of making deep cuts into your budget, because I don't want to risk losing that. It's very important to this community that we keep that accreditation. So I appreciate that you're being responsible this year. I just want to keep in mind, as other counselors, going into the next year, that possibly next year we could be looking at a higher percent, over just a little bit over 2% to help make up for that shortfall.
Thank you, Councillor Ryan.
Thank you. That's it, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Councillor Ryan. Town Manager McCall?
No, I just wanted to contribute to that dialogue. Part of the reason we were conservative, I know councillors were concerned about FY22. We saw what happened in FY21. People were scrambling last spring, I know, in the previous community, trying to anticipate the impacts of COVID. We did see some trends with regard to some of our local option taxes, our excise tax, our meals tax, our hotel tax. Some of those things had taken a hit during COVID. So when we were forecasting, we were anticipating that we would still see some of the effects of COVID in fiscal 2022. So that is part of the reason behind the level service budget, so that we didn't overestimate and find ourselves in a situation where we're running into shortfalls. One would hope by the time we get to FY23, we will see normalcy in all of our revenues. We also did not factor in any of the federal stimulus money. We still don't know how we're going to be able to use all of that. I sat on another MMA briefing today. They're still waiting to hear guidelines on some of the ARPA monies, and then there's the infrastructure. So we don't know how that will play out. But at the time we started the budget process, we were being conservative. So hopefully in the next fiscal year, revenues are restored. We have guidelines to how to use some of that money, and then we can go back to funding as we should for the library. And that holds true for pretty much any of the budgets that come through this evening and in the next couple of meetings that we have with all the various subcommittees. That was the mindset when we started out planning for FY22. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else here? Councilor Daniel?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, through you. Good evening.
Hi.
On your library books and materials line item, that's $42,000. Does that include digital materials?
Yes, it does.
And are you increasingly purchasing more digital and less cloth books?
Yeah, we're making the change. The ratio is definitely changing, and we scrambled to do it on the fly in the initial stages, because we do have digital materials, but it's the amount of digital material now that we're purchasing is so much more significant than what we had in the past. But we do still have an audience for the tactile, traditional materials. So it's a question of trying to, satisfy all the needs. And I think it's working out pretty well. And because we're in a system which is supported by the whole library network, it only takes a couple of days, even if we don't have the material, that somebody wants right there, we can get it in like a couple of days, and vice versa, we can send it out. We have a very high ratio of sending out materials, what we have in our collection is quite valued by our colleagues throughout the state, in other libraries as well. So it's a reciprocal system, which we all subscribe to. We've just increased, just in relation to digital, we have just subscribed to a new database called Newsbank, which will give us the Telegram and Gazette as, you know, as the daily paper. We'll be able to look at it online, and it'll be available to the public. And we feel that that's something that will be appreciated. And it also has like a genealogy section or a heritage section, which will be able to access obituaries going back to 1900, so from newspapers. So these are, pretty substantial changes that are taking place, and I think everybody's expectations have changed too. You know, as people started to be more comfortable in the digital environment, they are making more demands. But as I say, we are still keeping an eye on making sure we have physical books. So be assured that we have a nice mix, I hope. And as I say, it's can be substituted by our colleagues in the network as well.
Do those digital purchases satisfy the requirements for you to receive those matching funds?
Pardon, I didn't hear the full question.
Do the digital purchases that you make satisfy the requirements for you to receive the matching funds from the state?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Right. Everything counts. Yeah, it has to, because we're so close. But no, it absolutely does. And the state has been very... has been actually very supportive of libraries and very understanding of, you know, the peaks and troughs that we've all dealt with across the state, and have been there for us to help us, you know, answering questions and helping us doing layouts, you know, changing the whole traffic patterns and all those sort of things, especially in the initial stages. So we're grateful for that as well. You know, it's not just the state aid funding that they provide us, but it's also the consultations that we can get and the professionalism that we're tied into. Thank you.
The $2,000 for the small capital budget, is that an estimate that you got somewhere, or is that something that you've done in the past? How did you come up with the $2,000?
It's really a guesstimate, because I haven't had a proper quote for the facade, but the emphasis was on small capital items, so I actually paid attention to that, and I feel that we will supplement any money from state aid that the library has access to.
Yep.
So I feel that's, you know, in the overall picture of trying to keep within the parameters that were set out in this FY22 budget system.
Okay, thank you, that's all.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else have questions? Anyone online? Councillor Steeves?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Two quick questions. One actually following up on what Councillor Daniel just brought up. I was curious, Margaret, how do you decide what you take as text versus what you take as digital?
There's often overlap, especially in the more recent publications, because some people want the new book and to be able to download it, and other people want to actually have the physical copy. So, as you've probably noticed in the collection, we often have books or titles, I should say, in many different formats. We can have a book, a paper, you know, a hardcover book, a paperback, now a digital copy, an e-book, but an e-audio as well, a physical audio book with CDs, and we could have a DVD as well, from a book to convert it to a movie. So it can be, you know, it's incredible how there are so many formats to fulfill, and we try to do it as best we can, and supplemented by our interlibrary resource system that we share with other libraries in Massachusetts.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
And the other question I had is, I was curious if you could give us a quick summary of how much activity did you actually see this year with COVID?
Well, it was
obviously you were doing the back door takeout of stuff, books and stuff, and obviously I participated in that pretty frequently. But can you give us a quick summary?
It wasn't what our normal activity would be, and traffic pattern. And initially, I think people were just you know, fearful and didn't want to go anywhere. So we experienced that where, you know, people were only doing errands that were really necessary. And I don't think the library factored into that for a lot of people. But we have built up a steady clientele. People are coming back to using, picking up materials. But we also have people who have now made the switch to the digital because they were forced into it initially and then they actually got used to it. So it'll be interesting to see when people have all things being equal choice where they can have the item in the traditional format or on, you know, through a digital download to see whether or not they are interested in going back to the traditional way. And we will adjust accordingly, you know, when we start seeing, you know, people's preferences and how they're actually, you know, walking with their feet, so to speak. But, you know, we would love to see more people, as always. I think, you know, that's what we try to do with our outreach, is to try and promote the services of the library. And, you know, the schools, we have put up some resources for school kids and for their parents specifically, because we felt that that was a target group that really could use some assistance. So we subscribed to a new database earlier, it was probably in FY20, which is called Brain Fuse, and it actually provides homework help. And it's pretty robust, and there was also a second part to it on jobs, on job searching and how to prepare yourself for the employment market. So there are all digital resources that we have now subscribed to. So we are making the change, and it's sort of as we see a need and learn about the different products that are out there and trying to make reasonable purchases based on the need and what we think will work with the community. So it's a question of really promoting the services.
Okay, thank you. And the last question I had is kind of a curiosity thing. I know I've read and seen some references to some publishers of ebooks and things like that purposely minimizing the number of times they can be borrowed before requiring another purchase. Have you run into that issue?
Indeed, we have. It's not just self-publishing. Some of the items are metered, is what they're calling it, and they allow you to have a certain number of loans of that material or borrowing of that material, and then you have to re-up in order to, you know, resubscribe in order to have that in your portfolio. And that was something that Library World had protested about maybe 6 years ago, and successfully. Collins was the publisher at the time, who had started this trend, but unfortunately has become more pervasive. And there's really, we're the consumer, and if we want that item, we either have to take it in the format that it's being offered, and if it's metered, so be it. But hopefully, because other libraries are subscribing as well, and everything is shared on the databases, all the libraries in CWMRs, that's our network, they all share their electronic resources. So ebooks and e-audio is available. So if Charlton buys it or Sturbridge, our patrons can access it. So it's a very cooperative symbiotic system.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else have any questions?
Mr. Chair?
Karen? Ms. Arnoyce?
Yes, thank you. I don't have a question, but I just wanted to point out that if the council is supportive of the upgrade for the position for the circulation supervisor, that Margaret has been working on a revised job description for that position, and we will bring that forward. And the revision to the Schedule 1 to change it from an S7 to an S8. We'll bring that forward at that time.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone have anything else to offer? Councilor Marchetti.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, through you. Hi, Margaret. I enjoy going over to the library. I think it's one of the best places to hang out in town. When do you think you might be open again?
Very soon. That's about as much as I can commit to at the minute, because I haven't actually spoken to the town manager or to the board of trustees,
okay,
who would be the people who would, you know, consult on this. But we're getting ready.
All right.
So it hasn't been fun for us to being behind closed doors, and we, I think the staff always appreciates the interaction with the public, and that's what we do best, is, you know, the customer service part. So
right,
we've kind of missed that.
Yeah.
So we're getting ready.
Yeah, I miss going over there, seeing all the artwork.
We'll send you an invitation.
All right.
We'll
Thank
send
you.
Out the message as soon as we're in place. Thank you.
I spoke to you a little while ago about increasing Wi-Fi. Has anything been done with that?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Right after you asked.
Yeah?
Yeah, so we have increased an access point in the parking lot. And actually, there's a map that I was just looking at the other day, and it actually specifically says that there has been an additional access point. Mass Board of Library Commissioners has a map throughout the state of all the Wi-Fi points in the libraries, and it's actually described in there. So yeah, it was about $1,000 of an increase, but we were able to do it because we have that budget line item for IT, and we used it for that because it was important. Our service does stretch to the whole perimeter of the library, so out onto Main Street, where the cars park, you should be able to get Wi-Fi, and sitting on the benches, and that's the whole idea of, you know, serving the community, is to make it accessible. So for anybody out there who's interested in connecting to the library, it's library hotspot is what it's called when you see the choices.
All right.
Thank you.
I think it was it last year you were talking about replacing some, was it AC on the roof? Was it AC or was it?
Yes, it was an emergency request. In December of 2019, I came to the council because we had one of the rooftop unit number two, had failed. And fortunately, it was in only, you know, it was a zone, so that was a section that we weren't really using so much, that people weren't actually sitting there. It was an area where people browsed books, just walked around the shelves. So it was fortunate that we were able to go through the process of doing the procurement and coming to the council and asking for emergency capital funding, which we were awarded. And it took until February, the early February, for the company to actually get the whole thing in place and installed. But once they got going, it was done. So it was done in early February. But every week I would call and remind them of, you know, we're here with temperature in one section of the building not being at what the desired temperature, and, you know, we need to work on this. But it was the procurement of, you know, it was a big unit. And we have four others, just as a reminder.
Okay.
But the according to the study that was done for the facilities management study, it predicted that 20 years is what you would normally get, 20 to 25 years, I believe. So hopefully the others will be a little later. That's where I have placed them.
All right.
To replace them is at a later time. You know, not. We're hoping this was the lemon.
All right. I actually used to I used to work for Newsbank. It's a pretty very interesting company to work for, and they do a lot of digital scanning. And they may even talk to them about scanning some of your old newspapers, because that's what they do. And I think they actually, where I work, they paid the library to scan the books, because then they also have access. I don't know if they're interested in that, but...
Well, I did ask, actually, because yeah. I thought before we made the commitment to buy the product, maybe that was a good time to actually see if they might want to scan the local newspaper.
Right.
And they said that they didn't have that as part of their portfolio, and they had no plan to add
okay.
at the time. But the Southbridge News, if you do subscribe, does go back on digitally to March 2008, I believe. I was just looking at it today. So we have access as the library. It's not public access. We have just our subscriptions to the physical newspaper, and then we get a digital one as well. But ideally, that would be the case. And the Mass Board of Library Commissioners is working with Digital Commonwealth, who have done the digital library for our library. We have the town reports, we have the school yearbooks, and we have some photographs already digitized. And that was done gratis through Digital Commonwealth and the Digital Public Library of America.
Yep.
So I'm waiting for them to say that they will pull the trigger on the newspapers. They're talking about it and have been for a while, but that'll be the next step.
That would be excellent. And yeah. I've seen all the Digital Commonwealth things for Southbridge on there, and it's really quite amazing. My last question actually is for the town manager. You said that there could be you were speaking about a shortfall in revenue. How are we doing in revenue this year as far as taxes that are coming in? I know that last March there was some talk about it being a shortfall in tax revenue of $1 million at the time. I'm just wondering where we stand with that now.
We have Ms. Harnois on the line. I don't have an up-to-date number. She has not alerted me that we're in any dire situation with regard to that. Maybe she could weigh in on it, but when we were talking and planning, it never came up that we were falling behind. We had some, as I said, there were some areas that we were concerned about, that being hotel and motor vehicle excise, but I don't have a dollar figure for you today. She might be able to comment.
All right, if you could get that to me, I'd be appreciated. She does have
her
hand up.
She has her hand up. So.
Yes. Ms. Harnois?
Sure. What I will do is I will get an update of where the revenues stand currently, and I will send an update out to the council and the town manager.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
That's all I have.
Thank you, Councilor Marchetti. Does anyone else have questions? Councilor Dyer, Citizen Member Dyer?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I don't have a question per se, but for the benefit of the group, I would like to share with the group that I do sit on the Library Board of Trustees, and I want to echo the comments from the town manager at the beginning of Margaret's presentation, commending her for her leadership of the library through such an unprecedented year on such a skeleton staff. I do think the maintenance of the circulation activities in this environment was really remarkable, and she put the best interest of the staff in the entire town first and foremost in her decisions to be conservative about limiting the public to the library spaces while maintaining those circulation activities. I would encourage those of us that sit on the Education and Human Services Committee to adopt this budget. I do think Margaret is a good, strong director and manager of her team, and I think that she puts the best interests of the physical plant of the library and her staff first and foremost to preserve it as the gem that it really is in our community. So that's all for me.
Thank you. If there's nothing further, I'd entertain a motion.
The motion was made at the beginning, Mr. Chair, by myself and then seconded by Mr. Daniel, if I remember correctly.
Thank you. We will take a vote. Councilor Daniel?
Point of information. Is this including the recommended change?
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you. Councilor Ryan?
Yes.
Citizen Member Krista?
Yes.
And Citizen Member Dyer?
Yes.
And I'm a yes also. Thank you.
Thank
for your presentation
much.
This evening.
Thank you very much.
Moving on, agenda item number 3. Review the fiscal year 2022 Community Center and entertain a motion
so
to vote to submit to council as presented.
So moved, Mr. Chair.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you. Questions? You're opened up to the town manager first.
Yes, we have Ms. Haddock on the line who will be happy to talk to you about the budget. I won't repeat my remarks from earlier, but as I said, we same philosophy going into all these budgets. And again, Ms. Haddock, for obvious reasons, we did not fill the recreation director position. When I came on board, the individual there had just left. We made a decision due to COVID. At the time, the restrictions, at the phase we were with the reopening was such that it didn't make sense to try and have outdoor recreation programs in the late summer, early fall. But now that things are again coming back to normal, we're in phase four, step one. I've talked to Ms. Haddock about posting that position so that we can get back to some level of normalcy and offering the programs that we should for the citizens of Southbridge. And with that, I would hand it over to Ms. Haddock.
Thank you. Ms. Haddock.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. We'll start with the community center budget. Salaries is first up. Our salaries are very different. We share support of salaries with my salary is paid 60% by the town and 40% through the grant for the senior center that we get annually, the Council on Aging grant. So that being said, it's a seven total salaries for the community center is 7% increase. Our custodian is also paid half from the town budget and half from a special account that we have here at the community center from the rental of facility. And that you can see the breakdown on the budget that you all have. Do you have any, okay. Electricity is the same. We did not go up at all on that. Water and sewer has the 4% increase that the town manager requested that we put in. Everything else is pretty level funded. We did take away the office supply and copy machine costs because those are covered also in our formula grant money. So we didn't need to have that $500 in here, but we did need to increase our janitorial supplies. So you'll see that that went up by almost the $500, mm-hmm. Which we did away with. And that is pretty much the school budget.
Thank you. Open it up to questions. Town manager.
I'm going from memory because I'm not finding my notes, but I want to say that the salary line was impacted by the increase in the minimum wage. I know when we looked at addressing the at least Earl, our custodian salary, when we were doing services for the EDS, that we had to adjust it. So I believe that's part of the salary increase and explains some of the increase.
I'm sorry. That's true. I'm sorry. I should have said that.
No, thank you. Questions? Questions? Councilor Marchetti?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, through you. I don't really have any questions about the budget so much, but I think that it might be a good idea to start looking at some CDBG money for some of this. I'm not absolutely 100% sure that we qualify, but I know that senior services do qualify, so do public services. Some of the rules are kind of funny, can't be used if it's already funded, but there are exceptions to the rules. So I would just encourage that we do look at some CDBG money for some of these. If we qualify for them, then I think we should go for it. I know recreation is also included in CDBG, senior center, senior services, all services qualify. So if the town manager wouldn't mind looking into it, I appreciate it. Could be we don't qualify for it, but it wouldn't hurt to look into it. So thank you.
Thank you. Karen, did you have something? Ms. Arnoyce?
I do. Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to point out the increase in the salary
is from Pat as the community services director because she's still on steps. So that's what it is. With Earl Bond as the custodian, the full amount of his salary is shown there, but then you can see the actual offset is the full amount because it's covered half by the grant and then half by the revolving. And I just wanted to point out anyone that was looking at the top summary page, you can see where the 2020 actuals is zero. That's because the fiscal 21 was the first, just want to remind everybody, fiscal 21 was the first year that we broke out the community services and the veterans budget. So that's why we don't have any actuals yet. This fiscal 21 is the first year of the split.
Thank you. Anyone else have any questions? Anyone online? Councilor Steves?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One quick question. I was curious, where do things stand as far as hiring a new recreation director go?
The position has been posted. I haven't checked with Kim, but hopefully we'll be interviewing soon.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Councilor Dyer, or Citizen Member Dyer?
No questions.
Very good. Okay. Thank you. With that being said, we'll move ahead to our vote this evening. Councilor Daniel?
Yes.
Councilor Ryan?
Yes.
Citizen Member Christo?
Yes.
Citizen Member Dyer?
Yes.
Thank you, and I'm a yes as well. Thank you all. Moving on to agenda item number 4. Review the fiscal year 2022 recreation budget and entertain a motion to vote to submit to council as presented.
So moved.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Town Manager?
Good evening. Let me just grabbing a couple things here. Got to double check which are we on, the veterans or the recreation?
Recreation.
Okay. So again, consistent, I pulled out the veterans ahead of schedule, that's fine. Ms. Haddock should be able to explain, but again, no significant increases here. We have had some requests, I know, as you know, recently about doing some improvements on some of our courts. We will be looking at that. There's been some money in the past that's been set aside. It's not reflected in here, but it's something that I know a couple of councilors have touched upon. But this operating budget is consistent with the prior year. There's only some minor increases again in the salary line. If you have any questions, I would just refer them to Ms. Haddock.
Thank you. I'll open it up for questions. Councilor Ryan.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Through you, I see that we have a 2.9% increase in the salaries and wages, but there's no one actually in the position.
No, that is for the summer program people, and we kept those positions open. Again, there are five staff members who are reflected in the increase for minimum wage, and that's what that increase is. Again, if we get a recreation director and can get a program up and running this summer, that would be great, and that's where those positions will come into play. But we just kept them in the budget so that we could have them if we could open up this.
Okay, that answers my question. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Councilor Marchetti?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, through you. I was actually going to suggest we eliminate this position because, well, I don't really see, somebody could explain why we need this position, but then I was looking at CDBG money and realizing that it can be used to hire a recreation person. Maybe that's something that we should look at. As I said, there are some rules about hiring. It can't be funded if the funding is already there from town for municipal taxes. However, if the level of service has decreased for reasons beyond your control, then you can do it. So if COVID isn't beyond our control, I don't know what is. So I don't know what the recreation director does. For a long time, we never had a recreation director, and we still had programming in town. So I know if we are going to hire one, maybe we should hold off to see if we can get the grant money for that position. And that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Ryan.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, through you. I know we haven't had one for a while, but I know the recreation director ran a lot of the programs in town. Steve Rodenfeld did a lot in town when he was here, and he was only part-time. So I don't want to eliminate a position to then only need it as COVID, hopefully, is on its way out, and not have the funding there for somebody to help run a summer program if it's looking like it's going to be good this summer. I would like to have return to normalcy and have those programs up and running, and you really need a recreational director there to help run those programs. I wouldn't want to put that extra work on Pat on top of what she's already doing right now. So I would feel comfortable, at least right now, leaving it in as is.
Thank you. Myself, I'll make a quick comment also. I support this position as well. I look forward to the summer programs coming back in this community. It's important. I think it's an important position for this community. When you see the summer programs and you see the kids and what good it has for this community, it's something that I'll be fully supporting going forward. Councillor Adams.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I completely agreed with what the town manager did earlier this year and the community director did as well, not hiring somebody on during this during the COVID. But I will say, if anybody goes around these parks, they probably need a little bit of help. And instead of throwing it on the town manager, throw it on the community director, throw it on the DPW, put that recreational director. And if that recreational director is worth his salt or her salt and weight, they're going to do great things for the town and for the community and those children that needed so much as far as those parks and all the other recreational events that happened throughout the town. I would even go so far as to, I know it's a little late in the ball game with this right now, but as we move forward to look at actually increasing the hours, so we don't have the revolving door of recreational directors for our community. Appreciate it. That's all I have, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Councilor Ryan.
I just want to respond quickly and say I completely agree, Councilor Adams. I personally think it should be a full-time position. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have anyone else? Seeing no one, I'll take this to a vote. Councilor Daniel?
Yes.
Councilor Ryan?
Yes.
Citizen Member Christo?
Yes.
Citizen Member Dyer?
Yes.
And I'm a yes as well. Thank you. Moving on, agenda item number 5. Review the fiscal year 2022 veterans budget unclassified and entertain a motion to vote to submit to council as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Mr. Town Manager, and I also think Keith is online. Yes, okay. Mr. Town Manager?
Okay, so Keith is up there. Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Again, as was the case with the prior budgets, level service, really no change in the expenditures. It's just the significant change comes on the salary line. We have step increases, and we do have Mr. Roberts here who can address any questions for you.
Thank you. Mr. Roberts?
Hello, Mr. Chair, Town Manager, Councilors. Thank you. Hello, everybody. First line item is salary and wages. There is a 6.71% change from last year to the new year, or the current year to the new year, and it reflects the step change from MS-15, step 3 to a step 4 and the 2%. It doesn't show it on the actual budget, but that is a director position for the district, which includes income that comes from the other three towns. Charlton, Oxford, and Auburn. The original, what I know of the numbers, was 16,000 from Charlton, 8,000 from Oxford, and 8,000 from Auburn. And Karen could probably speak more to it, but I think they get an increase as to what they're gonna pay as well as the year goes on. I'm not exactly sure about that. The next line item, unless Karen wants to speak to that, would be the grades officer, which is just a 2% roughly increase from the 1421 to the 1449 for the 2022 projected budget.
Thank you.
Next item, there's no change in pretty much anything else in my budget. Office supplies remains $200. Mileage and in-state travel, $150. I did not do any conferences or travel last year because I don't think anybody did based off of COVID, but we are projecting to have our summer conference this year as of now. And that's basically trainings that are put on by the state through the Department of Veterans Services that basically covers whatever hotel fees or travel. And that's also in the conference and meetings. There's fees for all of it, and part of that is the hotel. The next line item is the dues. I'm a member of the Massachusetts Veterans Service Officer Association as well as the Worcester County, and that covers both of those. And you've got to pay for membership in order to be part of any of the trainings or anything that goes on throughout the year that will just enhance whatever I can do or learn to become a better veteran service officer. And that's the basic budget for the office. The next thing would be the veterans benefits themselves. Nothing's changed there. I didn't ask for any increase. What we had from the previous year was $135,000. And what we have for veterans on benefits currently, that'll cover. And I didn't want to decrease it because we have two or three veterans that I know are coming back to the town, projected to come back to the town. One that was in a rehab position, and one's coming from another town. And then another one had left the state and said he's coming back, but we will find out in the budget that we have requested will cover those veterans coming back on. The other thing is for the memorials and supplies and materials, and basically that's the $2,700 that has been pretty much the same for many years, from my understanding, and that gets turned over to the Veterans Council and the trustees to help take care of all of the monuments and memorials in the town. And that's my budget. Providing any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Roberts. Any questions? Councilor Daniel.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good evening. Can you give me an example of what some of the veterans' benefits are? You know, what's comprised under that line item?
Well, basically, it depends from scenario to scenario. Every veteran has their own scenario. But basically, low income, it's a social service. And for the most part, depending on what their rent is or what 504 or when it comes to if the rent has heat involved or they pay that out of pocket, then that is something that the it works into the calculations. All those benefits as a whole, providing they are approved by the state, basically part of my job is to do all the applications and submit to the state for approval. As long as they get approved, 75% of all the monies, so that total budget, whatever is spent throughout the year, let's say it's $135,000 from the request, if it's all approved via through the state, because that's where it goes first, we will get 75% of that back from the state, back to the town. And again, it's based off of many different scenarios, and it all depends on what the veteran status is and what they actually pay for their monthly rents and heating and things of that nature. And medical bills are included there as well. If they are on Chapter 115 benefits, majority of them also are qualified for medical benefits that are reimbursable through the state and then through the town.
Very good, thank you. That's all I have.
Thank you. Any other questions? Any questions? Anyone have a question online? Citizen Member Dyer?
No questions.
I can't see everyone. Seeing no questions? Okay, I will move ahead and we'll take a vote.
Councilor Daniel?
Yes.
Councilor Ryan?
Yes.
Councilor Christo? Citizen member?
Yes.
Christo? Okay, thank you. Citizen member Dyer?
Yes.
And I'm a yes as well. Before we end this evening, thank you, everyone. Thank you to the town manager and Ms. Harnois for putting the budgets together this evening. I think it went very well. With that, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Motion to adjourn has been made. Councilor Daniel?
Quick question before you adjourn.
I couldn't hear. Would like to ask a question.
Councilor Steves?
Yeah. I was just curious. I did email it to you, but I don't know if you saw the email. Is there any particular reason why the health department's budget is not on this agenda?
He wanted to know why the health department's budget wasn't brought up tonight.
Because it normally is.
Mr. Chair, if I could.
I believe it's going to be done on the... Go ahead, yes, Ms. Harnois?
Yes, it's because Mr. Pelletier is away. And it's going to be, I believe it's going to be done along with the school a little bit later in the month.
It is, yes.
Okay, thanks.
That is correct. Thank you. Okay. Motion to adjourn has been made. Councilor Daniel?
Yes.
Councilor Ryan?
Yes.
Citizen member Christo?
Yes.
And citizen member Dyer?
Yes.
I'm a yes as well. Thank you, everyone. Have a good evening.
Good night.
Thank you.